Hello, all. Good to see you. Anke Mulman here. Our website is cwowi.eu. Welcome. Today I want to talk to you about, actually this is part one. Oh, by the way, before I forget it, if you speak Dutch or you are from a Dutch-speaking nation, of course, in 30 minutes I will do the same teaching in Dutch. But you are welcome to listen to me, of course, in English. As you can hear, I am not an original speaking English person. Okay, today, have you become a Pharisee? And then this is part one, and then I want to talk about Korban. Then you think, have I become a Pharisee? No, of course not. You are offending me, Anke. No, I'm not offending you. I just want you to listen and to search your own heart and to give you some understanding so I can help you. Have you become a Pharisee? And of course you think, no, I did not. First, I have to explain a little bit what is a Pharisee, how about the history and how about their oral law, how that became bigger and greater than the written word of God. Well, the Greek conquered Israel, that was around 300 BC, and then their culture, of course, spread the world, and they, well, the Greek brought their roads, they brought their spas, they brought their sporting events, they brought their fashion, their currency, and so on. And within 100 years, you could not, it was hard to tell a Jew from a Greek. And of course, a lot of people were not pleased with that. And he thought, we have to do something. We have to separate again the Jews from the Greeks so people know what is a Jew and what is a Greek. What is a Jew? What do the Jews believe? So there arose a holiness movement around 150 BC, separating the Jews from the Greek. And they were known as the separate ones. And actually, the word Pharisee is separate ones. But they needed to organize something and to be able to teach people the word of God. So they started home-based congregations. And in the Greek, that is the word synagogue. So, and they decided, well, there's only one day left because we have to work. And the law of Moses says you cannot work on the Shabbat, on the Saturday. So let's come together on the Shabbat and let's teach on the Saturday the people the word of God. So that's how the worship on the Shabbat began. But actually, Shabbat originally was just a day off from work, not to work. And later on, when they expanded, they moved to buildings. And that's what we have today in a Jewish culture and in the Jewish faith. But the heart of the Pharisees was actually to teach the people the written word. But how do you apply the word? And there are many, how do I say that? Well, they had to teach the people how to apply the word. You know, when the word says, do not work on the Sabbat, what does it mean when I have to go walking to a shop or whatever, get my stuff? How far can I walk? And that is not work, you know. So they decided on they needed like a limit, how far a person could walk before it would be work. That was called a Sabbath day walk, and they decided it would be around a quarter of a mile or 500 meters. And that teaching eventually became oral law. Now imagine there were many more rules like the Sabbath day walk. And those rules in the course of time, they were elevated above the written word of God. But God's intention always has been and is still today that people would walk with him, that they would know him, and they would interpret how to apply those rules, those laws from God, by their walk with him and by them getting to know him and walking with him. But the oral law, what the oral law actually did, they took the responsibility away from the people and decision away from the people, and they replaced it with rules what the people should do in certain situations. What to do when you are sick, what to do when you have a crisis, what to do with your children when something goes wrong. And those rules had to be followed. And then the ministers in that time, and especially in Jesus' time, they became controllers of the people to make sure that people were following the right rules. And I understand their heart. They did not want to offend God, and they want to be sure that they did everything right. But instead of walking with God and getting to know him, they did not do so. And they did not teach the people to walk with God, but they set the rules and they tried to find a way how to apply those rules. And those rules, eventually, that was the oral law. So for the people, their walk with God became one of works and one of performance. And people were always fearful that they might have done something wrong, that they might have offended God, or if they violated God's law, maybe God would be so displeased with them that he would not answer their prayers. And then what to do? So then they probably went to offer a sacrifice to God to appease him. So the oral law removed any relationship with God, and it replaced it with rules and regulations and with religion. That's actually what religion is. Religion is not a relation, but it's a set of rules and regulations. So, and the oral law made the people dependent on their teachers, because the teachers knew what to do. The teachers knew how to apply it. And when I have a crisis in my life, I go to the teachers. They will tell me what to do in any situation. And that is actually the world that Jesus walked into. And let's look at an example of an oral law that was elevated above the written law of God. When you go to Mark 7, I will read a little bit. It says here in verse 1, the Pharisees and some of the scribes came together to him, having come from Jerusalem. Now when they saw some of his disciples eat bread with defiled, that is, unwashed hands, they found fault. See, they were looking to see if the disciples or anyone else was doing something wrong, and they found fault. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they wash their hands in a special way, holding the traditions of the elders. It was not a law it wasn't a law of Moses, but it was a tradition of the elders. And when they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And there are many other things which they have received and hold. And verse 5, then the Pharisees and scribes ask him, why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but they eat bread with unwashed hands? And he answered them and said to them, well, did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites? As it is written, this people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me, and in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. That was the oral law. They taught commandments of men as a doctrine, as the written word of God, but it was not the written word. For laying aside the commandments of God, or nullifying the commandments of God, you hold the tradition of men, so that those traditions were elevated and became greater than the word of God, the washing of hands and stuff. And he says to them, all too well, you reject the commandments of God that you may keep your tradition. So they rejected it. For Moses said, and then the Lord tells them what they actually are doing wrong. He says, for Moses says, honor your father and your mother, and he who curses father or mother, let him be put to death. But you say, if a man says to his father or mother, whatever profit you may have received from me is korban, that is a gift to God, then you no longer let him do anything for his father or mother, making the word of God of no effect through your tradition, which you have handed down, and many such things you do. So what was exactly the case? Well, the Pharisees were criticizing the Lord's disciples for eating with unwashed hands, not just in a hygienic sense, but it was a ceremonial cleanse. They cleansed themselves from any defilement, so to speak, from contact with Gentiles, because they consider Gentiles to be unclean. But the law of Moses says, honor your father and your mother. And honor is not just lip service, but it included the idea of caring for them in their various needs. So korban was a gift or an offering that was consecrated to God. And here in Mark, it refers to money that was dedicated to God. So actually, what was going on? What was the situation that the elders, the father and the mother, were saying to their kids, I need some help because I need money or I need other help. Can you please help me? And then he said, no, yeah, I do have some money, but you know, it's korban, it's dedicated to God. So I'm very sorry, mom or dad, I can't help you because it goes to God first. And he says, this is so wrong. Because you no longer let him do anything for his father and mother, and therefore, because that was an oral tradition, you make the word of God of no effect through your tradition. It was not in the word of God. The word of God says, honor your father and your mother, take care of them, help them. So how do you see that today in charismatic circles or in other circles? Is it not true that oftentimes we are taught, you know, first you give to God and then God will take care of your needs. God will take care of your parents' needs. If your parents are in need, or who else, or someone else that is close to you in your family and needs some help. But you say, so I'm sorry, I can't give it. I do not have the money because I have I have to give God first, and then he will supply. I will pray for you, and I'm sure that God will meet your need and will do whatever he can. Then you are, when you think like that, then you have become a Pharisee too. Wow, that is something. So what they did, the Pharisees, and what the oral law does, it takes away the responsibility to walk with God, to hear from him what to do. And they walk, and people started to walk in fear, being afraid that they did something wrong. You know, when your prayers are not answered, I probably have done something wrong. And you look back to your life there and always wondering what to do, what not to do. But God wants a relationship. He wants us to walk with him, and how to apply those rules and those laws from Moses, or love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, and everything that's in you, and your neighbor as yourself. How do you apply that? How do you have like regulations for that? This is how I do it. Or do you walk with God and hear from him? So next week I want to talk about some other oral traditions and how that applies to us, and how we see that in our lives sometimes. If you are honest, you know, and I'm honest to myself, I have done things like that too, but I have repented from it, because it's so much better to walk with God and have that relationship with him. Hope to see you next week. Bye bye.